going to be in the, of course, we're working through the book of Deuteronomy. We're going to be starting in chapter 10 tonight. And it's an interesting couple of chapters. And really, I mean, this section of Deuteronomy, but it's just like the Lord is again and again telling his people, obey me and love me and I will bless you. Turn your back on me, walk away from me, worship other gods, and the word uses curse you. And we'll get into how that's really not an issue for us on this side of the cross being cursed anymore, but by God for our shortcomings. But it seems like about four times in these two chapters that's the issue. He's just simply telling them, here's the deal is so simple. I mean, you have the most amazing life possible ahead of you. A nation of unimaginable possibility. And the deal is so simple, you know? And I'm not asking you really to do anything that tough, you know? And he does a lot of different ways. And just reminded me as we were going through Isaiah, and I was sort of going, man, is everybody getting tired of Isaiah, God through Isaiah saying the same thing over and over again through 66 chapters? And it just reminded me that, you know, why are we encouraged by God to be in the Word every day? Because we have to be reminded every day of the same things. We're dumb, that's right. We're dumb sheep. And so as we go through something like this tonight, we shouldn't be looking at it, okay, I can't believe, you know, he's telling these people, and if anyone needed to hear it again and again, it's the Israelites, right? I mean, if we know the history of them once they go into the Holy Land. But to sort of set up the beginning of chapter 10, I mean, the word Deuteronomy meant second law, okay? And it's sort of the idea of the God is sort of, God through Moses is recounting the law to his people a second time. He's sort of revisiting the law as it was given on Mount Sinai back in the book of Exodus, okay? But in addition to this, tonight Moses recounts historically, well, in the book of Deuteronomy, he recounts historically the entire 40-year Exodus, but, you know, from escaping to Egypt to entering the Promised Land, but it's sort of the Cliff Notes version. And I realized when I did my notes, how many people there would be that didn't know what that means to say Cliff Notes. Because to me, in my high school days, that's the only thing got me through English Lit, you know. You think I'm going to read Madame Bovary from start to finish, you're nuts, you know. I mean, I'm heading right to the bookstore and getting the Cliff Notes on that. Hope there's enough there to pass the test, but I got to remember not to date myself with these examples, but we're sort of getting the cliff notes were a synopsis of novels like War and Peace. I wore out my cliff notes on War and Peace in high school, but at any rate, it's a shortened version. It's the essential things, and it's conveyed to the people of Israel during Moses' last 40 days of his life. I mean, that's sort of what we understand the time frame of Deuteronomy to be, his last 40 days. Okay, and he's aging man, 120 years old. He's sitting there in front of them is the Jordan River on the hill, and the horizon is Jericho, the first city they're going to have to conquer. You know, so sort of like the first challenge is already in sight, and it looks like probably a big city with big walls, and he's just realizing that this is such an important moment in the history of these people, because he knows God said, you're not crossing over. Your days end here, you know, and he got to know that for at least 40 days in advance. I don't know. It'd be interesting if the Lord, you know, told us, okay, boom, 40 days to go. What would I do tomorrow? You know, 39 days. Okay. I think we would be really different Christians if that happened, right? But here's the deal. He knows he's no longer going to be able to, the people aren't going to be able to come to him for counsel. They're not going to be able to come and get advice on either the word of God or the counsel of God. And he's going to be departing, and so he's giving them this final charge, and these things, and the repetition, these things must be so important to him. He says them again and again, please get this. Now last week in chapter 9 we ended where God reminds the people that, you know, he wasn't giving the Israelites this amazing promised land. I love it. He talked about it. It was not because of your righteousness. Okay, you got that? I am not doing this because of how righteous you were, but because I chose you. Because I loved you before the foundations of the world, and this is my covenant promise to you. And they have very well proved they're unrighteous, right? We'll go through the whole golden calf incident, right? Hello, in case you guys forgot, okay? It's not because of your righteousness, but because you're my chosen people, So chapter 10 is now going to recount once again how God provided the law and consolidated it or encapsulated it into the Ten Commandments written on two stone tablets. That's sort of where we are here. Verse 1, at that time the Lord said to me, cut for yourself two tablets of stone like the first and come up to me on the mountain and make an ark of wood, referring to the Ark of the Covenant. Verse 2, and I, this is God speaking, and I will write on the tablets the words that were put on the first tablets that you broke, and you shall put them in the ark. So now Moses says, so I made an ark of acacia wood and cut two tablets of stone like the first and went up the mountain with the two tablets in my hand. And verse 4, and he, God, wrote on the tablets in the same writing as before the Ten Commandments that the Lord had spoken to you on the mountain out of the midst of the fire on the day of assembly. So I'm sure this is where we get the idea it got written in stone, right? Okay, this is written in stone. Or it's not written, that was not written in stone. Okay, God wrote this with his own hands in stone. Verse 5. Then I turned and came down from the mountain and put the tablets in the ark that I had made, and there they are as the Lord commanded me. Okay, so what we have here is basically God reissuing the law, okay, in case you guys forgot. He wanted his written word to be the starting point for their walk with him. Therefore, he restored the tablets, himself writing it with his own finger. So, powerful picture of the inspiration of God's word. Though God did not literally write the 66 books of Holy Scripture with his own hand, like we have situated here, right? He did perfectly guide the minds and hands of those who he had called to be his lips, his voice, and to write, you know, and thus that we can say of the scriptures they are God breathed, as Second Timothy 3:16 says, given by the inspiration of God. You know, getting right with God after a time of rebellion always has to begin and center in God's word. So this is after the golden calf incident. This is the second time he brings the tablets down, okay? And in fact, it's interesting that every revival in the days of the kings of Judah always included sometimes a rediscovery of the scrolls of the Old Testament. They lost them. And they're going, hey, we're looking at a musty old box, and guess what we found? These scrolls. Let's see, this one's called Genesis, you know? Whoa, I've never seen that. Someone reads it to the king. Wow, that's crazy good. And they bring all the people, and there's revival. It goes on, you know, but then they'll forget it, and then they'll refine it again, all the way to Ezra and Nehemiah at the rebuilding of Jerusalem and the temple. And Ezra just shows up, man, and there just is a revival of God's word. You know, it's sort of interesting, when I birthed this church, my first three sermons were out of Ezra, recounting the story of how the people were starving for the word of God. They said, they told Ezra to go get the scrolls and bring them and read them to us, you know. And I love remembering how important God's word is. Verse 6 is sort of interesting parenthetical paragraph. The people of Israel journeyed from Beeroth Ben-Jaakan to Mazarah. There Aaron died, and there he was buried, and his son Eleazar ministered as priest in his place. And from there they journeyed to Gudgada. Now, hey, that's the Bible. Don't yell at me. Sounds like Gudgada. To Jotbatha, a land with brooks of water. At that time, the Lord set apart the tribe of Levi to carry the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord, and all of us to stand before the Lord, to minister to him and to bless his name. Boy, what a beautiful calling in life. To this day, okay. Therefore, Levi had no portion or inheritance with his brothers. The Lord is his inheritance, as the Lord your God said to him. Okay. So God ordained that this people needed priestly leadership. It's sort of just establishing the Levites have a role for you as a nation in my worship. They have a role between you and me, Jehovah God. You know, and I love their basic job description: to stand before the Lord, to minister to him, and to bless his name. And for us today, being saved by the work of Christ on the cross, we find ourselves dependent on the priestly ministry of Jesus Christ. And what does the word of God say? He stands before God all day, interceding for us, praying for us, glorifying the name of God the Father, pointing our hearts to God the Father, you know. And so nothing's changed, you know. And God just saying, you know, you guys work best with a mediator, you know. So we pray to Christ and he takes care of things. But the people here trusted the Levites to be their mediation physically in the physical world, you know, in the temple and before the Lord. Verse 10 says, Moses here, I myself stayed on the mountain as at the first time, 40 days and 40 nights. And the Lord listened to me that time also. Moses was basically, I'm jokingly saying, talking the Lord out of wiping out all the Israelites for the golden calf thing. But it actually says, the Lord was unwilling to destroy you. I would say the topic was raised, in the end, God didn't do it. Moses prayed amazingly, the Lord. And it may be the Lord wanted to see Moses' heart about this, because the Lord actually makes a pretty incredible deal. Remember that? He says, here's what I should do. I'm going to destroy all of them. I'm going to make a new people from you. And you're going, wow, that sounds like a pretty good deal there. I will have an entire new people from myself. But Moses doesn't go, just doesn't even take the bait. And he just stays on his knees and says, no, Lord, don't destroy these people. Look what the Pharaoh will say when he finds out. Look what all the Midianites will say when they find out that, you brought your people and you couldn't even save them and killed them out in the desert, And so don't let your glory be tainted, And I think God was just testing Moses to see, what's your heart about me? And so I love what it says. The Lord was unwilling to destroy you. Verse 11, and the Lord said to me, arise, go on your journey at the head of the people so that they may go in and possess the land which I swore to their fathers to give to them. So don't miss this. After a huge and epic fail with the golden calf, after the people repent, God says, okay, time to move on. We got more life to live. Okay, let's just go. Confess, I should say that with our lives of faith in Christ, we're going to have epic fails, with differing frequencies in our lives, right? But Christ is all about moving on. Confess, repent, pray for forgiveness, and let's get on with this thing, okay? We fall, he stands there in front of us, so we stand up moving forward, okay, in the direction, at the point we fell. Oh, it's okay, but Christ's hand is there. Let's get up, okay. Confess, repent, move on, let's go. You're covered. My blood got that taken care of. Anyway, the next message we get is always to keep your heart soft towards the Lord. And the Lord lays out five things here, five things he would love to have his people do. And verse 12 says, and now Israel, what does the Lord your God require of you but one, to fear the Lord your God, right? First commandment. Two, walk in all his ways, obedience, right? Three, I love this, these men love me. All I require of you is love me. Love me. Keep it personal and relational. Abba, Father-like. The name a child used in Aramaic for their actual father. They would cry, Abba, Abba, pick me up, whatever. And God wants that kind of relationship, right? And this means the love he expects isn't a love that just happens, but I think it's a love that comes from a decision to express our affection to him. I mean, love is a decision, right? It's not all emotion and feel good. True love is a decision to love, to express your affection towards someone. And God desires that very much. The fourth thing he says, serve the Lord your God. And listen, do it with all your heart and all your soul. None of this half-hearted stuff. Be a God follower on that side of the cross, right? Verse 13, and the fifth thing, to keep the commandments and statutes of the Lord, which I am commanding you today for your good. All of God's laws were to bless the people, were to protect the people, were to help the people. And so he's saying, listen, you need to follow them because they're going to protect you. They're protective. Just like the Sermon on the Mount for us is, it's protective. Okay, and it helps us understand what Christ expects for us. But these five things are just simple things. But I love the middle one is to love him. Love him. Okay. So five things is all he asks. How are we doing? How did Israel do? Well, I think Paul summed it up in Romans 3:23. Well, we've all sinned and come short of the glory of God. We didn't, we don't pull it off all that perfectly. And you know what I was thinking? If every man, woman, and child lived according to these five requirements, if everyone was walking in the ways of God, loving each other as they love themselves, walking in harmony with God, what a fabulous world this would be. I think we get to experience it for moments, in our life, and certainly to some extent when the body of Christ gathers, sometimes maybe at retreats and things like that. We have those little windows where we just imagine, what if I went to work and it was like this? How cool would the world be? It generally isn't. Man's failed. That's the truth of it. Rather than referencing God, we more often, the unbelieving world blasphemes God. Rather than loving and serving him, man rebels against him. And even us believers, at times, we fail to walk in all his ways and to love and serve him as he would ask us to do. But thankfully, are we lost? No, there's hope. You know, it says, I just was reminded, went back and looked at this. They came to Jesus with a question. It was, what must we do to do the works of God? Okay. In other words, the people now are asking Jesus, okay, he's a rabbi, what must we do? Okay. And what does God require of us, basically? Jesus said this, this is the work of God, that you believe on him who he has sent. You believe on him. So our job, our work, is to believe on him whom God the Father has sent. Him would be Jesus Christ. Well, instead of five, we have one, okay? I can do that. Praise the Lord, I can do that. And though we fail in pulling off the ideal, which would be just a broader, you know, but, you know, I've never sinned outside of faith in Jesus Christ. I've sinned though I have faith in Jesus Christ, you know? I'm imperfect, but it's never been a lack of faith thing. It's just been a weakness of my flesh and my desire for the things of the flesh and the world, right? But, you know, but we're called to believe on him whom he has sent. I've never lost that belief in my darkest moments, right? So that's the good news. The good news is, too, for us on this side of the cross, is that as we believe on Christ, we receive a new dynamic for our life. Christ actually comes in himself. Elsewhere, he describes sending the Holy Spirit of God, you know, so it's not just a white-knuckle faith. Okay, in my own strength, I'm believing and having faith, but we are empowered from within by the presence of part of the Godhead, right? And that really is what makes such a difference in being a true Christ-following Christian. The Holy Spirit guides me in the love that I need for God. He begins to work in me, doing for me what I can't do just by myself, you know. And so God's never given up on the divine ideal, but now he's got the work of the Holy Spirit to help us do far more than we could ever do on our own, excuse me. And so the moment we commit our life to Christ, we're fulfilling his requirements, because he's going to come in and take care of a lot of what we just can't do, right? And so what a blessing. It's interesting. It triggered my mind when I looked at that verse, and it began, you know, what, you know, begins with a phrase, what does the Lord require of you? And I went, there's another one. It says, what does the Lord require of you? And it's in Micah 6:8, not a big deal. Don't even turn there. But it says, he has told you, O man, what is good, and what does the Lord require of you but to do justice, to love kindness, and to walk humbly with your God. Okay, so there's three things there. I'm not going to go in and exposit that passage. You could argue that those things do fold into the five. Those three can find a place under one of those five things there as well. But I just, you know, what does the Lord require? You know, and it's never the impossible, right? Verse 14, let's keep moving. Behold to the Lord your God. Behold, to the Lord your God belong heaven and the heaven of heavens, the earth with all that is in it, okay? Yet the Lord set his heart in love on your fathers, that would be the patriarchs, and chose, in other words, that's God's election of Israel, and chose their offspring after them, you above all peoples, as you are this day. So it's sort of like amazing. I'm the God who made the heavens and the heavens of the heavens, and yet before all of that, I loved you. I chose you to be my children. So again, we've sort of gotten that idea once before, but... So he's God saying here, this is the whole deal. It's a personal thing from my side. It was all birthed in my love for you, a love that it's unique and special amongst all the peoples of the earth. Now, John 3:16, God so loved the world. Okay, but nowhere ever is there ever kind of this expression, certainly in the Old Testament, of God's love for other peoples, the way he expressed it for his chosen people, the children of Israel. It's a very special love and a special relationship. But with the coming of the new covenant in Christ, we get the same idea, John 3:16, for God so loved the world. So, this has always been personal with the Lord. It's always been personal. And just as God wanted more than just mechanical obedience to the law, but his own people to be in a genuine loving relationship with him as well, so too Christ wants it to be very personal, a heart thing, a thanksgiving thing, a loving thing, a trusting thing. A thing between him and us. And we're to love our Lord Jesus, you know? I mean, he died while we were yet sinners. He loved us before we first loved him. We you know, and that should, that remembrance of that should always keep this personal and intimate and loving, the decision to love our Lord and Savior. And so God's going to get into this heart thing in an interesting way. In Old Testament verbiage, is to speak to, telling the people, listen, you need to circumcise your heart. Verse 16, circumcise therefore the foreskin of your heart and be no longer stubborn. Okay? You shall be circumcised in the flesh of your foreskin, and it shall be a sign of the covenant between me and you. Okay, so that's important. It says it's going to be a sign. So there was this physical act performed among young boys or males, whatever, when they became a Jew and confessed faith in God. And it's generally done, though, on newborn children 8 days after they were born. But it's a sign. And in Scripture, a sign is a symbol or symbolic act which points to a reality behind it. So God instituted circumcision as his covenant sign for Abraham and his descendants. But he always intended this to be far more than just physical. And when, if you go back and look in Genesis, you'll see he says it right there that it's supposed to be more than physical. It's symbolic. It's something deeper, too, that it represents. It's something, I mean, I'm not going to get graphic, but it's something that you're to be reminded of every day a couple of times, you know? Okay, if you're a guy. Okay, so I'm going to say, probably shouldn't have said that. But the point was, it was to be a remembrance, okay? It was to be a remembrance that you are a child of God. Verse 16 here explicitly recognizes Israel's need to change its heart. God was seeing the physical proof of circumcision, but he wasn't really seeing the inner spiritual commitment to the covenant. I think he's still worried, you know. This is the second generation out of Egypt. They lost a lot of ground in that 400 years in Egypt as far as understanding the relationship with God, okay? And so he's still not really seeing what he wants, but he's still drawing them to what he desires. But here's the deal. It's going to be a continual problem for hundreds of years. And ultimately, we already know sort of the end of the story in Jerusalem, that God's going to finally be forced to destroy the northern kingdom of Israel and exile the southern kingdom, you know, because they just never can, as a nation, get the heart thing right. You know, Jeremiah witnessed the exile of Judah from Jerusalem to Babylon. He said in Jeremiah 9:25, "Behold, the days are coming, declares the Lord, when I will punish all of those who are circumcised merely in the flesh." And then he gives examples of uncircumcised nations. He says, "Egypt, Edom, the sons of Ammon and Moab, for all of these nations are uncircumcised, but all the house of Israel are uncircumcised in heart." And Jeremiah saying, even though you've been through the ceremony, you're no different than the people that never were, because it's meant to be symbolic of something that happened in you. Romans chapter 2, 25, and also verse 28, "For circumcision indeed is of value if you obey the law, but if you break the law, your circumcision becomes uncircumcision. If you're not obedient in your heart, it doesn't matter that you've had that done." 28, "For no one is a Jew who's merely one outwardly, nor is circumcision outward and physical, but a Jew is one inwardly, and circumcision is a matter of the heart." It's a matter of the heart. So it was said in the Old Testament by Jeremiah and by Moses and by God, circumcise your hearts. But also on this side of the cross, Paul recognized that as well. And so really, circumcision, maybe you could think of it as symbolizing removing the stubbornness that prevents our heart from properly loving the Lord. I mean, maybe that's sort of the idea, that if you don't do that, you're not really loving God. Verse 17, "For the Lord your God is God of gods and Lord of lords, the great, the mighty and the awesome God, who is not partial and takes no bribe." He's just, right? "He executes justice for the three people groups here, for the fatherless, the widow, and he loves the sojourner." The three main, these are both categories of landless people. You could add to that the Levites, right? They were never given actual land in the promised land like the other tribes. The Israelites were a nation of sojourners, by the way, in the Exodus. And he says, execute justice for these landless people, giving them food and clothing. Love the sojourner. Therefore, for you are sojourners in the land of Egypt. God's saying, hey guys, you should always have a soft spot in your heart for sojourners, travelers, strangers, foreigners, because you were once a nation of them. Excuse me. Okay. It's interesting. In Jerusalem, in Israel today, I think they're trying to honor that, because they have this thing called Aliyah. Aliyah, and when we go in the summer to go to Jerusalem, but this is the bringing back of the scattered Jews across the world. They come on Aliyah. It's a pilgrimage, but it's a one-way pilgrimage, okay? Back from where they be. So they're coming these days from the Russian, old Russian republics. They're coming from Ethiopia, is a big place. They're having all these Jews leaving Ethiopia, who've been for 1,000 years. They're coming to Israel on Aliyah, and Israel's welcoming them, these people, and giving them food and a place to live and all that. We'll probably be doing some ministry to some of these people, okay? Interesting. Anyway, verse 20. For you shall fear the Lord your God. You shall serve him and hold fast to him, and by his name you shall swear. He is your praise. He is your God who has done for you these great and terrifying, perhaps awesome is a more appropriate word there, who's done these great and awesome things that your eyes have seen. You know, remember what he did. You know, the obedience God calls for, he always sort of sets it as, if you need a reason, just remember what I've done. You know, God didn't sort of ask for obedience before he'd done anything. He sort of asked it after he'd already begun blessing people. You can look at Abraham, same idea. You know, our service and our obedience as Christians should be based on what Christ has done for us. Thus, it should be grateful in nature because of the goodness that we've had poured out on us. If there's a lack in obedience and reverence, if there's a lack in a desire to serve or bless the Lord or his kingdom, it's almost always a lack of appreciation for what the Lord's done. You're just not thankful. You know, I don't know whether you're thinking you deserve it or something, but boy, when you're thankful, boy, you're ready to give back to the Lord for what he's done. Verse 22. Now your fathers went down to Egypt, you know, 70 persons, and now the Lord your God has made you as numerous as the stars of heaven. He's reminding them, you know, I made a promise to Abraham when he was barren. I said, your offspring are in a number as the stars of heaven. And Abram's, you know, 100 years old, looking at his 99-year-old wife. They have no kids, been barren their whole life. And going, well, and Isaac. Isaac had a family. Jacob had a family. 70 people go to Egypt, where Joseph protects them during the Great Famine, right? And then Moses brings 2.5 to 3 million people out of Egypt. And God's just saying, I keep my word. I keep my word. And you should want to obey me as you remember that, you know. I'm a promise keeper, if you will, okay? So to wrap up chapter 10, let's just say God's laid out the old covenant ground rules, and it is the faithful, heartfelt obedience to God and his law and his covenants. But it's obedience based not on human strength so much as the love of God in your heart. You know, that's, if you can find that, you're going to do good. If you try to do it in just your own personal strength, you're going to struggle mightily. I think the rest of the Old Testament is going to serve to demonstrate that the vast majority of men and women were just unable to stay faithful to God in their own strength. You know, and thank goodness we only know this covenant, where we get saved and we get the Holy Spirit of God in us, and how much easier, honestly, it is to honor the Lord when we have God at work within us, right? So it was hard for them, even though they knew exactly what they needed to do. They knew exactly how God would bless their obedience and love and would curse their unfaithfulness. And that sort of line of thought now gets carried into chapter 11. Verse 1 says, you shall therefore love the Lord your God and keep his charge, his statutes, his rule, and his commandments always. So here it is saying it again. Okay, just understand this is an artificial chapter break. This is just Moses continuing his sermon. There was no chapter 11. Okay, we're in chapter 11. Now but here it is yet again. Okay. And again, it's, you know, one reason to do this is to remember, to consider what God's shown in regard to his faithfulness, even in light of their rebelliousness. Verse 2 says, consider today, since I'm not speaking to your children, okay, who have not known or seen. So basically, anybody standing there under 40 years old never saw what happened in Egypt. They were born after that, okay? So some of the things he's going to talk about happened then. Okay, so that's what that little parenthesis is about. Consider the discipline of the Lord your God, his greatness, his mighty hand, and his outstretched arm. Verse 3. His signs and his deeds that he did in Egypt to Pharaoh, the king of Egypt, and to all his land. And what he did to the army of Egypt, to their horses and their chariots. How he made the water of the Red Sea flow over them as they pursued after you. How the Lord has destroyed them to this day. And what he did to you in the wilderness until you came to this place. So that then takes, in addition to just getting out of Egypt, just the whole 38 years of providing food and water and sustenance for the people while they're in the wilderness. So God had preserved them and provided for them. Verse 6, he goes on, and what he did to Dathan and Abiram, the sons of Eliab, son of Reuben. He's referring to what's called the rebellion of Korah in Numbers 16. We studied that a few months back. You know, Korah wanted the Levites. He was a Levite priest. And he says, we should have the same rights and privileges as the Aaronic priests, okay, who actually got to serve in the Holy of Holies in the holy place, right? And so he lined up 250 tribal leaders and said, okay, we want to go up and stand up to Moses and demand that we be made priests, okay? And so that doesn't go so great when they do that. And in fact, Korah and Dathan and Abraham and the 250 leaders basically get swallowed up by the earth, okay? And there was a lot less complaining after that. Okay. But anyway, it goes on. He says, how the earth opened its mouth and swallowed them up with their households, their tents, and every living thing that followed them in the midst of Israel. For your eyes have seen all the great work of the Lord that he did. Okay. Anyone else out there have a complaint? Step forward. Okay. Crickets. You know, I'm just going back to my tent now. Anyway, I love this. I love some of the stories of the Bible, right? So anyway, these are some events from the book of Exodus and Numbers. And all of them good reasons to love the Lord your God and keep his statutes, right? Moses is now going to speak to obedience for the purpose of having success in the coming invasion. Okay, you need to have me on your side. We're about to go to war. Okay, verse 8. You shall therefore keep the whole commandment that I command you today, that you may be strong and go in and take possession of the land that you're going over to possess, and that you may live long in the land that the Lord swore to your fathers to give to them and to their offspring, a land flowing with milk and honey. For the land that you are entering to take possession of, it is not like the land of Egypt from which you came, where you sowed your seed and irrigated it like a garden of vegetables. Okay, so it's interesting. He's saying, you know, they actually thought pretty highly of Egypt. You know, every time they had a problem with Moses, they're going, oh, why did you bring us out here to die? It was so awesome back in Egypt, right? You know, oh, we loved it, you know. And there's an interesting little thing here, and he's going to make an interesting comparison. Okay, he says, okay, I get it. You were in Egypt. You sowed your seed. Now, it says you irrigated it. I think some of the old King James versions talks about you pumped water with your feet or something like that. And the Egyptians actually had these foot-operated little water pumps that would bring up a bucket at a time, because they'd have to bring water from the Nile up to the land that they were trying to irrigate. And the soil is really pretty lousy in Egypt. It sort of also depended on an annual flood of the Nile just to bring nutrients. But then the river would go back, and now they had to irrigate it because it rains like an inch a year in Egypt other than that flood season, right? But anyway, he's saying, listen, okay, where you're going, it's not like Egypt. Yeah, stuff will grow. Stuff grew there. You had gardens of vegetables, okay? But it took a lot of human effort. It took a whole lot of human effort. But there's going to be something different about the promised land. Let's look at verse 11. But the land that you are going over to possess is a land of hills and valleys, which drinks water by the rain from heaven. And I put in parens, not irrigation by man, but rain from God. Okay, in other words, he's saying, I'm going to be doing what you used to have to do, because this is the promised land, right? Verse 12, a land that the Lord your God cares for, the eyes of the Lord your God are always upon it from the beginning of the year to the end of the year. I love verse 12. So it's God who cares for this land, providing the essential rains. The promise of the blessing of rain was important because one of the most popular Canaanite gods was Baal. And guess what? That was the Canaanite god they would pray to for rain and for successful harvests and such things. Okay, so there it would not be hard to imagine that there'd be a temptation. Well, we're in Canaan now. We better worship the Canaanite god of rain. And God's going, no. Don't do that. I've got it covered. Okay, and he makes it clear that if they worship and obey him, he'll supply abundant rain. It reminds me of the story of Elijah and the 400 priests of Baal. In that very place where it was a little different there. They were in a 3.5-year drought. Elijah had called against King Ahab and his lovely wife, Jezebel. And heartwarming. They're probably not going to cover her in the women's Bible study, I don't think. Don't think she'll make
unless
the cut
it's a on that.
Jezebel never makes the cut. Okay. But anyway, I just love that story because, you know, there's 400 prophets of Baal. And there they're trying to get God to bring fire down and consume an offering. Okay, a little bit different. They can't do anything. Baal does nothing, you know. And Elijah says, well, maybe he's over going to the bathroom or something. That's why he's not hearing your prayers, you know. Has a little joke on it. And then God, and Elijah makes like one 10-second prayer, and then here comes the rain. Here comes the rain, and the drought ends. You know, sort of an amazing example of what God was saying here before the ever even went into the land. Now, I just want to say this about verse 12, that it really hit me. You know, we have a missions team going to Israel, and I just saw verse 12, that Israel is a land that the Lord your God cares for. Israel is a land the Lord your God cares for. The eyes of the Lord your God are always upon it. And for some reason, that just resonated in my heart. We're going there to minister to the people of God in the land that he cares for. And that his eyes are always upon it. And thus, I just feel like we're going to be working under the gaze of God amongst, in his promised land, among his beloved people. Okay? In a season, we're not going to understand exactly what we accomplish, I think, in some ways. In some ways we will, but in some ways we won't. But just I just saw that verse. That might become sort of a prayer verse or something for our missions team. I felt like the Lord gave that to me to understand that what we're going to do, don't ever think it's mundane or unimportant. But in fact, it's something that's being watched by the Lord God. You know, and I just think it's possibly, to me, it's already been powerful to me as I'm thinking about going in May. Verse 13. And if you will indeed obey my commandments that I command you today, again, note, if you will obey my commands, that's like the 10th time, okay, that I command you today, and look at what the first thing he mentions, to love the Lord your God, okay, it begins with loving God, and to serve him with all your heart and with all your soul. He will give the rain for your land in its season, the early rain and the latter rain, that you may gather in your garden and your wine and your oil, and he will give grass in your fields for your livestock, and you shall eat and be full. That's a promise from God. If they had remained faithful, he's saying, you would not know drought. Okay? Israel knew drought. But as you read the stories, you know, you understand why. You understand why. They couldn't do this simple agreement continuously, right? Lurching and stopping and going, and sometimes they were, but many times they weren't. And the thing I like to think about what God's talking about this land, it's not only the promised land, but it's also the land of promise. God's making a bunch of promises here about it, isn't he? It is a land of promise where God is going to fulfill what he says to those who are faithful and obedient to him. And so all the problems that lie ahead for the Israelites are not going to have much to do with God or his promised land, but solely with their hearts. And Moses is going to hit on this again in verse 16. Take care lest your heart be deceived, and you turn aside and serve other gods and worship them. Sadly, prophetic. 17, then the anger of the Lord will be kindled against you, and he will shut up the heavens, so that there will be no rain, and the land will yield no fruit, and you will perish quickly off the good land that the Lord has given you. Okay. Sadly, this is ultimately what happens. You know, God casts both the nation of Israel and the nation of Judah out of the land and into pagan lands for their lack of faithfulness. In fact, their rebellion against him. And the promised land becomes the land of promise removed, sadly, because of their unfaithfulness. Of course, it can be avoided. Verse 18. You shall therefore lay up these words of mine in your heart and in your soul, and you shall bind them as a sign to your hand, and they shall be as a frontlets to your eyes. You know, we talked about phylacteries the other night, a couple of nights ago, times ago, where they, and we'll see this in Israel, and we go to the Wailing Wall, they have these boxes on their forehead, and I think their left top of their wrist, with black straps, they're always black, and there's scripture verses in there. I'm just not convinced that's really what God had in mind. Like I said, I'm glad God didn't say nail them to your forehead, because there'd be people trying to do that, right? You shall, but basically, but these words of mine, verse 19, you shall teach them to your children, talking of them when you're sitting in your house, when you're walking by the way, when you lie down, when you rise, you know? Verse 20, you shall write them on the doorposts of your house and on your gates, that your days and the days of your children may be multiplied in the land the Lord swore to your fathers to give them as long as the heavens are above the earth. And so, you know, we might smirk a bit looking at the Jews today strapping on their phylacteries and nailing their mezuzahs to the door. But let's be honest that as Christians today, it's very easy to wear a cross but not actually be willing to bear the cross of Jesus Christ in our life. You know, I've been convicted sometimes of that. It's much easier to hang scriptures on our wall in the house rather than to hide God's word in our heart, actually. You know, don't even get me going on bumper stickers, you know. I mean, it's sort of the same thing, you know. But anyway, the Holy Spirit's always examining us in our faith. Are we wearing or bearing? Are we hanging or are we hiding in our hearts our faith and trust in Christ? Because He knows the real deal in each and every one of us, where we're at. Verse 22, we have another. You will be careful to do all this commandment that I command you to do, loving the Lord your God, walking in all His ways, holding fast to Him. Then the Lord will drive out these nations before you, and you will dispossess nations greater and mightier than you. And again, it's referring again to God's word, isn't it? The written word of God, do all these commandments, certainly that's referring to the law, okay? It's to be learned, it's to be memorized, taught, written, but most importantly, it's to be done, lived, and lived out. And faithful obedience will be rewarded in verse 24. Every place in which the sole of your foot treads shall be yours. Your territory shall be from the wilderness to the Lebanon. Okay, so that means like basically from Egypt to Lebanon, okay? And from the river Euphrates, not the river Jordan, the river Euphrates over between Iraq and Iran, from there to the Western Sea, the Mediterranean. This is 10 times bigger than Canaan is, okay? And that's basically, they don't even ever conquer all of Canaan. But this is the Abrahamic promise. God told Abraham this dimension, from Lebanon to Egypt and from the Mediterranean to the Euphrates River, which goes right through the middle of Babylon, right? And that's like, well, I had a map way back when in Numbers when we saw this and just realized, wow, what Israel could have been, what potential they had at this point, getting ready to move in. I mean, everything was possible. Isn't that amazing? God was ready to do amazing things. Verse 25, no one shall be able to stand against you. The Lord your God will lay the fear of you and the dread of you on all the land that you shall tread as He has promised you. You know, when Israel walked in love with the Lord and was obedient to Him, they were unbeatable, man. When they had it right, they were unbeatable. No man could defeat them. Greater was their God who was with them than he, the enemy, who was trying to possess the promised land, right? With all of his, you know, demonic peoples, etc. But God promised to fight the battles for an obedient Israel. And you know what? When you look at the history of Israel, they never lost a battle. When they prayed and they went into battle with their hearts right and they'd asked God to be with them and lead them, they won. But there's a bunch of battles where they didn't do that, and Israel would get beaten. You know, sometimes even when they would be all sanctimonious and haul the Ark of the Covenant out in front of them, but it was a heartless act, and that's how the Philistines ended up with it for, you know, I don't know, 20 years or something like that, right? Because they were foolish, saying, "Oh, we got to do this mechanical act," but they hadn't truly asked God to go with them, even in that case. 26. See, I'm setting before you today a blessing and a curse. The blessing if you obey the commandments of the Lord your God, which I command you today, and the curse if you do not obey the commandments of the Lord your God, but turn aside from the way that I'm commanding you today to go after other gods that you have not known. Oh, man, so there it is. Again, how simple. Hey, blessing or curse? You choose. Choose which curtain you want, you know. Israel had a choice to obey and be blessed or to disobey and be cursed, cause and effect, reaping and sowing. You'd think it'd be such an easy choice. God just makes it blatantly clear. Here's the deal. Obey, be blessed, turn away, be cursed. But I think, you know, like children, you know, many of us have been parents in here. Most of us have been children. And we think of the times we willfully disobeyed what our parents said or our kids have, knowing what the deal is. You know, we've made the deal very clear or if you don't get home by such and such a time, or whatever, even something smaller than that when they're younger children. But kids will still disobey, knowing full well the outcome. There's just something in us that's like that. They deliberately defy the word of their parents as we can defy the word of God. But I think the Bible sometimes calls this tempting God. Let's see how far I get. Where's the edge really with God here on this little rule here? Let's see if I can get right up to that edge, okay? And usually we go too far. But anyway, again, it's a lack of the fear of God, I think, that we tempt the Lord. I wanted to say this, that in Christ, on this side of the cross, we don't have an old covenant relationship with God. And what I mean is the word curse. That is different. The Old Testament, he's going blessing and cursing. Not good to be cursed, and he would be cursed unfaithfulness, right? But because of our position in Jesus, okay, we expect to be blessed, but it's not because of our perfect obedience, because we're not perfectly obedient, but because of our position in Christ. Interesting, I was preaching that on Sunday in Ephesians 1, in verse 3, right? It's all about this whole, actually all of the first chapter is about our position in Jesus. And here's the deal. The reason curse doesn't apply to us is because the curse we deserve was laid on him on the cross forever. And so there is no cursing for us. There is no longer any condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. Is there chastening? Oh, yes. Is there correction? Oh, yes. Is there the diminishment or the removal of blessing or the extent of it? Oh, yes. Okay, for disobedience, but not cursing. Okay, that Christ took that for us once and for all. We're doing pretty good. Tell you what, let's just take a little detour to Galatians chapter 3. Do you mind? I just want to talk about this blessing and cursing a little bit. And there's Galatians chapter 3. Keep your finger here. We got a couple of verses to finish up. But Galatians 3, and we want to find verse 10. Verse 10. For all who rely on works of the law are under the curse, for it is written, cursed be everyone who does not abide by all things written in the book of the law and do them. Okay? That's from Deuteronomy 27:26. All I want to say is Paul in Galatians is speaking to Jews that have become Christians but still want to do all the Jewish stuff. They want to keep the law. They want to keep all the restrictions. All 667 little laws the rabbis came up with. And Paul, in the book of Galatians, is going, Jesus is enough. Jesus is all you've got to do. So when he says that right there, he's speaking, you know, cursed be everyone who does not abide by all things written in the book of the law. That's to people that are still trying to obey the law. But if you're a Christian in Christ, he's not talking to Christians there, but to Jews that are still trusting in the law rather than Jesus, okay? Verse 11, now it is evident that no one is justified before God by the law, for the righteous shall live by faith. Okay, it's actually from Habakkuk 2:4, but it reminds us that Abraham was judged righteous by faith before there was ever a law. Okay, verse 12 goes on, but the law is not of faith, rather the one who does them shall live by them. Christ redeemed us from the curse. This is what I wanted to get to. Christ redeemed us from the curse of the law by becoming a curse for us. That's the key. For it is written, cursed is everyone who is hanged on a tree, so that in Christ Jesus the blessing of Abraham might come to the Gentiles, so that we might receive the promised Spirit through faith. So I just wanted us to see why, as Christians, this curse language got left on the cross in Calvary. Okay? There's just corrective language now. There's chastening language. There's you can have a lot of blessing and favor, you can have a little bit. You know, if you sow unfaithfulness, well, you're going to reap way reduced blessings, etc. So I just wanted us to look at Galatians 3 and just understand that this curse thing on this side of the cross was left at the cross, okay? Verse 29, if you don't mind going back to Deuteronomy. Okay, we're just about ready to wrap up. And when the Lord your God brings you into the land that you are entering to take possession of it, you shall set the blessing. It's sort of interesting. He's saying, now, there's a big ceremony I want you to do when you get into the land, okay? There's going to be two mountains. One's called Gerizim and one's called Ebal. Okay? And I'm going to want you guys to do something when you get there. So let's just read about that. Okay? Verse 29 again. When the Lord your God brings you into the land that you are entering to take possession of it, you shall set the blessing. Okay, so he's talked about blessing and curse just in the previous verses there. You shall set the blessing. Okay, they're supposed to take the law, the blessing of the law, these promises that Moses spoke about blessing, and write them on big rocks and make an altar on this one mount. And the blessing is to be there, written out, okay, on the stone. And then it goes on here, and then the curse on Mount Ebal, same thing. Take these stones. What are the curse warnings that we've been seeing for the last two chapters? We're going to carve those into stone, set them on Mount Ebal, okay? And this is going to go in way more detail in chapter 27 and 28, but I just wanted to say that's what he's talking about right here. Verse 30 then goes on. Are they not beyond the Jordan west of the road toward the going down of the sun in the land of the Canaanites who live in the Arabah opposite Gilgal beside the oak of Morah? Whole bunch of Old Testament landmarks. All I'm trying to say, he's saying, I want you to do this when you're in the land. And he's sort of saying, God's saying, you're going to be in the land. It's going to happen. It's going to work. Okay? But when you get there, I want you to be thinking about this. Verse 31, it goes on. For you are to cross over the Jordan and go in to take possession of the land that the Lord your God is giving you. And when you possess it and live in it, you shall be careful to do all the statutes and the rules that I am setting before you. We made it. Okay, good. Now, what I wanted to say, it's a cool story. We'll wait and do it, but it's sort of neat. He's going to send half the tribes up onto the Mount of Blessing, and the other half of the tribes go up onto the Mount of Cursing. And then Joshua is going to be right in the middle, and the people, the Levites and all that are with him, will shout out the blessings of God, and everyone up on Blessing Mountain, that, you know, so what, I don't know, there are a million people? I don't know. They're all going to shout, Amen! Amen! And then they'll read, but! Then some cursing thing from the thing, and they'll read that and shout that toward, and all the people up on the Cursing Mountain, Amen! Amen! God did say those curses would be, you know, it's gonna be, and it goes back and forth. It's pretty cool when we get into Deuteronomy. Then in Joshua, it actually happens, and they go through it. But what an interesting picture! I sort of said, it's sort of like they're building this spiritual giant billboard in the middle of Israel that says, "Obey me and be blessed. Disobey me, rebel against me, and be cursed." You know. But anyway, it's going to be an interesting story. But once again, what we've seen, Moses has emphasized that the history of Israel is going to be determined by their ethical and moral behavior. I mean, their future is so much in their hands. You know, we say, you know, everything's in God's hands, but they are to be a people defined by their obedience to God's law and driven by their love of Him. Okay, so I think of the Mount of Cursing, and, you know, there's some people think that spiritually speaking, Christians, as Christians today, we're actually... You think about where we are in history, we're between two mountains too. We're between Mount Calvary, right? Where our curses, that's like the Mount of Curse, where our curses were hung on a tree upon the soul of a man named Jesus, who died for us and took our curses away forever. And on the other side, we're looking toward the Mount of Olives, where our risen Savior is going to return one day and bring with Him all the blessings of the promises in the book of Revelation, throughout the New Testament. So we really are between a mount of cursing and a mount of blessing, spiritually, symbolically thinking, and Christ is central to each of those places and did the work that gives it value. We live with a covenant now, not written in stone, but written on our hearts. Ephesians 1:3 says that God the Father has blessed us in Christ Jesus with every spiritual blessing, so we are blessed through the indwelling power of God. Romans 8:1 says, there's now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. And so we're no longer under the law, but under grace, but this doesn't give us license to sin, right? God's principles never change. Of one of those is that God blesses us when we obey and chastens us when we disobey. And as we walk through life in the power of the Holy Spirit, you know, we're able to overcome the appetites of the flesh and begin being more filled by righteousness. I was thinking Sunday, I spoke about how He calls us holy and blameless, that as we follow Christ, God sees us as holy, separated out from this world that doesn't put a second of thought towards doing anything that pleases God. And we become blameless. I explained that that's about, you know, when we sin, we recognize it and we try to, number one, confess it. But if our sin has caused harm, we try to make it right. We try to go to the person that we've sinned against and ask for forgiveness. Can I do anything to help undo what I did to you when I was blind in my sin? And when we go to try not to only confess our sin, but try to make that sin right, that's when God looks at us and considers us blameless. We've done all we can do. We've done all we can do. And it fulfills his desire, what we try to do. So that's our journey as Christians on this side of the cross, okay? Christ filling us more and more with him. So anyway, that's what I've got. So let's let me...